Second chapter, Pirkei Avos, Rebbe Omer. Ezo derech yishor shiyover lo'odom. What's considered the proper path that one should choose for himself? You know, the many paths which are permitted or even encouraged. But what is, of all the paths we choose, put it this way. If one has an obligation to say the Shema, it's not a choice. You have an obligation to say the Kriya Shema. If a person has to put on tefillin, it's not a path to choose. That's an obligation. At the Seder, you must eat matzah. You must discuss the bondage and the redemption. That's not a path you choose. That's something you must do. But in terms of normal behavior, you have many ways to do things. Which is the proper path to choose? For instance, I'll give you an example. It's ruled in Shulchan Aruch and in Code of Laws. The Ramos says that if one person can do a mitzvah privately or publicly, you should do it publicly. Why? Because when people see you do something positive, it's a positive effect on them. What about if you do, by doing the mitzvah, you're going to agitate those people? Because since they don't have an understanding of what you're doing, it looks something very odd, very peculiar. And therefore, you're going to ruffle feathers, and you have no reasons. You could do the mitzvah as well privately as publicly. So there, what's the point of doing it publicly? It has no value. You're only creating a negative. There's no positive. If you could do it publicly and you create something positive, a positive effect, people see the person as something special, fine. So therefore, that's something to draw a lesson from. But if it's something which affects and produces a negative effect, then what's the point? So which path should a person choose? For instance, the Talmud tells us, based on the verse in Mishlei, in Proverbs, when a person gives charity to a person, you should do it in a way that you shouldn't embarrass the recipient. Or you shouldn't do it in a way where people become aware that the person is needy. Why? Because if they become aware that he's needy and he has any assets and he wants to sell those assets, immediately he's going to have to sell them at a lesser value because people realize that he's pressed for the money. So therefore, when you, it should not be known that the person is needy if it's going to have this negative effect. So it's a question of choice. You're doing the mitzvah. You should help the person. In what context do you help him? So therefore, and as I always say in the name of Rousseau Salanter, he says, there's a fifth volume to our Shulchan Aruch, which was never printed. We have four sections to the Shulchan Aruch. There's a fifth section which was never printed. It's called Seichel. You have to have common sense. You have common sense, they all function. You don't have common sense, ultimately you destroy everything, you undermine everything. So Rebbe is saying, when you choose a path, it should be a proper path, a path which is understandable and palatable to others. As a result of that, he teferes lo sel. It's a teferes, it's glorifying the person himself. And not only that, teferes lo adam. Other people see him in a positive context, and therefore he's able to be that influencer, that role model, that takeaway of something good. The Gemara tells us, the Talmud tells us in Yuma that a person whose behavior is properly, who's proper, he speaks with respect or refinement, he interacts with people in a very positive way. What did they say? They say, fortunate are the parents who gave birth to him. Fortunate is the teacher who taught him Torah. And fortunate is he that he merited to have Torah. But if a person misbehaves, and he's seen in the negative, it's what we call, it's a disgrace to God. They say, woe to the parents that brought this person into the world, woe to the teacher who taught him Torah, and woe to this person, look what he's doing with it. So therefore, whatever we do, you should always take into account how it's perceived by others. Is it perceived positive or is it perceived negative? But again, but if it's an obligation, you have no choice but to do it, you must do it. This is just a question of you have a choice how or where or what context. That's what Rebbe is speaking about. There was a certain person, he himself is a Baal Teshuva for many, many years. And certain things irk him. He sees things in his community. And they should irk anybody. And he wants to respond and tell them they're doing the wrong thing. So the Talmud tells us, just as there's a mitzvah to say something when it has to be said, there's a mitzvah to remain silent because what you say will create more damage than anything else. So I said, if you have the capability, the capacity, and the know-how how to communicate to people that they should appreciate what you're saying, then you should say it. But since factually you don't, there's a greater mitzvah to remain silent, not to say a word. It's the same idea. Now, havizor b'mitzvah kala b'chamura, you should be as careful with an ordinary mitzvah as a more severe mitzvah. Why? Why should you be as careful with a less severe mitzvah as a severe mitzvah? Because factually, you don't know the true innate value of a mitzvah. And I always say, we read later in Pirkei Avos that Schar Bayal Maleko, that when one does a mitzvah in this world, God does not pay you in this world, does not reward you in this world, because there's not enough time and there's not enough goodness to be compensated for the mitzvah that you deserve to be rewarded for. That's any mitzvah, even one time. So if that is the case, if any mitzvah, regardless of the way you evaluate it, there's not enough time in life and there's not enough goodness in life to reward a person for the value of what he had done, what he accomplished. So it's clear your perception of what's not important enough, evidently it's a misreading. I'll give you an example. If a person has an opportunity, he could do $1 million deal or do no deal. He says, I only do $1 billion deals. You say the person's a fool, right? $1 million is not something to sneeze at. And even when you think it's a $1 million deal, who said it's even a $1 billion deal? Maybe it's a $500 million deal. What is exactly your yardstick to understand and evaluate the innate value of what you see as something to be less important? Evidently, if God said you must do it, it's important. It's not your perception. You know, drinking water may not be that important compared to certain other things. But when you need the water and your body has to be hydrated, it's very essential to your function. Well, but it's not the same as something else. It doesn't make a difference. But it's a necessity for your function at certain times. And you have to be sufficiently hydrated or other things in life. No, you should breathe so many times per minute. And your heart should beat, that your heart should not be damaged. You have to have a regular heartbeat. And if it's off, it's only one beat off. But are you a doctor, a cardiologist? You know what one beat off every minute, what it means? Ultimately, it may damage your heart. Do you understand? Well, I don't think it's important. What's your understanding of cardiology? Since when do you have any background or understanding? Well, that's my sense. But your sense means nothing. So in terms of the innate value of any of the 630 mitzvos, the 248 mitzvos, and the 365 negative commandments, do you have understanding what the negativity and the liability and the consequence and the damage and the ramifications of any of these are? How do you know? Well, it's my sense. No, there's an expression in English, don't judge a book by its cover. In terms of, don't see it negatively or positively because it may not be as rosy as you believe it to be. Don't judge a book by its cover because you don't know what's within that particular work. A mitzvah, if you see it as kala, unimportant, your perception or your evaluation or understanding doesn't mean anything. And even if it is correct, but factually, it may be less than others, but in terms of its innate value, it borders on the infinite. So if it borders on the infinite, it's irrelevant to the way you see it as being less than others, but factually, it's something which has unlimited value. Therefore, to pass on it or to minimize its value, you have to really be a fool not to really take advantage of the opportunity at the particular moment. The Talmud tells us that if a child is born into this existence and he only lives to a point as a minor, that he's able to answer amen on a bracha once in his lifetime, once he has a share in the world to come. He hears a blessing by another person and the child says amen. That's it, nothing more than that. He has a share in the world. What is amen? Amen is a confirmation of what of somebody says a blessing or says something truthful, and you say amen. Amen is an acronym for Kael Melech Nemon. Aleph is Kael Melech Nemon. God is what? Is the faithful God, powerful one. That level of acknowledgement, although the child has no understanding what it means, just answers that. Saying the words, those words themselves have literally give that child a connection to eternity. That when he dies, even God forbid at that young age, he will have a share in the world to come. Now, amen is not a mitzvah in the Torah, but how could you not acknowledge something which is truthful and correct without confirming it? So that confirmation has that value. So putting a penny in the charity box, giving the poor man charity, it's a positive commandment. And if you withhold the penny, you're in violation of a negative commandment. You're not permitted to withhold something from a poor person. So when you do it, it's a positive commandment. When you withhold, it's a negative commandment. Rashi cites the Talmud, that the Talmud says, to what degree are we deserving of reward? If a person loses a penny, not more, and a poor man finds it, and the one who lost it is totally unaware that somebody is a beneficiary of the penny that he lost, and that poor man benefits, the value of that mitzvah accrues to the one who lost the penny. Could you imagine? This is the value. Could you imagine? Because although it was unintentional, he will never know. In this lifetime, he will never know that there was a beneficiary of his loss. Although the loss was minuscule, almost something he doesn't value. It's a penny. What's the value of a penny? But if that person was able to benefit from it and he was needy, you're a beneficiary of his benefit. It's almost like absurd. It's ludicrous. No, it's not. You know, there's nothing in life which is just happenstance. Very often things happen and God wants it to happen. And we have a principle. God brings merit to the meritorious and he brings detriment to the ones who are undeserving. It's a fact. Those who are meritorious, God wants to present and create every opportunity for them. And that's an expression of God's love. Even when they're not even aware, person walks down the street, he meets somebody. And it happens to be a person who's really a special person. And you're happy to help that kind of person. And you have another person walking down the street and he meets a con man on the street. And he presents himself as a needy person. And he pulls your heartstrings and you give him money. So what happened? In one, your intention may have been right, but you were actually victimized by this con person. The other person, he meets the person and he's truly that special person. And the Talmud tells us in one location that you have to have merit, that when God sends you poor people, needy people, they should be truly needy and appropriate people. They should not be anoshim she'enim hugonim. They're inappropriate people. So again, it's this idea. If you're worthy, God wants to help you out and he's interested in your benefit. But if you're unworthy and you're not interested in God and you just happen to come upon it, you don't have enough merit to do the merit right. You know, on a fast day or on Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, we say Avinu Malkeinu. We say multiple, our father, our king, Chatanu Lefanecha, we've sinned before you. Then we say, Zochreinu L'chaim, during the after the fast that we say, we should remember it for life. We should be remembered for a livelihood. And on the 10-day period, we say, Kosveinu. Kosveinu B'Sefer Chaim. We should be inscribed in the book of life. We should be inscribed in the book of forgiveness. We should be inscribed in the book of livelihood. But we say, one of the things we say, Zochreinu d'schuyos, or kosveinu b'sei b'schuyos. Remember us to be meritorious. Right, inscribe us in the book of merit. What's the book of merit? What is it? You do something, you have merit. You don't do it, you don't have merit. You should be remembered for merit. You should be inscribed in the book of merit. The answer is, you have to be worthy to be meritorious. It's not so simple. Not everybody is worthy to be meritorious. You know, you have certain people, you know, based on the insurance charts, you know, there's certain people who are accident prone, even though it's not their fault. But if they're accident prone, they get a higher rating than someone else. But you can't fault the person. Another person has a better rating, although he's no less, more careful, less careful than the other person. He gets a better rating. Why? Because that's just the reality. One person has a negative, he generates, he attracts things which create financial loss to an insurance company. He's rated differently. The other person, not. Certain people, because they have certain merit, God says, because you're special, I'll bring you every opportunity. Of course, it's your choice. But since you're looking for that, you want to do my will. If you want to do my will, God says, more power to you. I will assist you to do my will. And this we just had. It says, kolabolitayer misainoso. If you really want to purify yourself, you want to upgrade in Judaism, and you're truly sincere, God will come and assist you. He will help you to get there. It may take a while, and you may have endless distractions, discouragements, but ultimately God is there waiting to help you. And therefore, you shouldn't be discouraged, because the evil inclination always will try to sidetrack you and totally get you off track. But if you want to sin, God says the opportunity, it's wide open. The whole world is that. That's free for. So, kosveinu b'sefer hazchuyos, inscribe us in the book of merit to be meritorious, or remember us for merit. Hashem, keep us in mind that you want to have a good deal, bring the good deal to me. As you always say, person brings you a good deal, you say, no, that kind of deal, always bring that good deal. Tell you a story. There was a certain person, story goes back maybe 20 years ago, and he was the nephew of the Chazon Ish. He was visiting the United States, and when you met this person, you could sense how special he was. Refined, you could sense his holiness. And he came to raise money for some institution that he's involved in Israel, educational institution. And when the man speaks to you, you almost feel privileged if you could help him. That's the sense he gives you. You feel privileged if you could help him. So, and I try to help him, make introductions. I called up, I'll even tell you the person's name, George Klein. George Klein, one time, was like one of the big real estate moguls in Manhattan. And I say, George, this person's here. He's the nephew of the Chazon Ish, and he knew who the Chazon Ish was very well. I said, can he come see me? He's trying to raise money. He says, of course you can send him. He meets him. I don't know how he helped him, but he called me up after. He says, that kind of person, as many of those kinds of people you want to send me, just send them. It was a privilege to help him. You understand? It's a privilege. But you understand, for that kind of person to come to you, to be helped, it's a privilege to be helped, to help that kind of person. Because that person is truly seen as special by God. You know, a person has an only child, and he goes off to a far off location, and somebody helps his child. And his child is made protected, made to feel at home. And every opportunity that's there, this person is involved in allowing that person to have the opportunity. How does the father feel about that person assisting his only son, the son that he loves more than anything in the world? To the father, that person is really special. So if you're out there helping and wanting to help and doing God's will, what is God going to do? God is beholden to you. God's beholden to no one, but God wants to be beholden to that person. He will bring that person every opportunity, because that opportunity is worth, has infinite worth, because that puts you in a certain place in eternity. So understanding that, you know, very often you have a case people come and they ask you to help them out, whether it's charity, do a mitzvah, participate. And they say, you know, I've had enough. I don't want people knocking on my door. I don't want my phone. I don't take phone calls anymore because, you know, it's too much. But factually, every person who came to him is really, we're not talking about anybody's trying to mislead him or take advantage of him. And God is knocking on his door continuously, continuously. It's like, you know, years ago, there was a show in the 50s. It was called The Millionaire. And the benefactor, he would choose a person that he would deliver $1 million cashier's check. In the 50s or the early 60s, $1 million was a lot of money. And he said to knock on a person's door. The person doesn't want to open the door. Knocks. Tries to do whatever he can. The man doesn't open the door. The one who sent the check wants to help him. He chose him out of endless numbers of people because he's special. You don't want to open the door. You don't want to be helped. You don't appreciate what God is offering you. Mitzvah kala. You have a charity box on the table in shul. Put a penny in. You know, when you tefillin is a very important mitzvah. It's called a sign. As we say in the Shema, a sign on your arm, a sign on your head. You identify with God. It's the insignia. A Jew has two insignias. One insignia is engraved in his flesh if he's a male. That's what we call the circumcision. As we say in the Birchas HaMazon, we say after we eat a bread meal, we say, Al-Brislo Shatsam B'Sarenu. The bris, the covenant, which is sealed in our flesh. That seal is identifying with God. That's Brislo Shatsam B'Sarenu. That's called Brislo Shal Avram Avinu. That's the covenant with Avram, we being his descendants. We have that seal. Then he gave us another sign. And bris is called Os. It's called Os Bris Kodesh. It's the sign of the Holy Covenant. And then we have a sign which we wear on our hand and wear on our heads, which correspond to our heart and to our minds. And the Torah says, V'ro amei oretz ki shem Hashem nikra lecho. When the nations of the world will see the name of God called upon you, v'yoru mimeko, they will revere you. They'll have trepidation from you. When they see that name of God on you, you carry that sign of God, they know, keep your distance. And you can't interact as with an ordinary person. What is that? So facts all we wear tefillin, the world, nobody's rearing the Jew because he's wearing tefillin. So there's a famous word from the Vilna Gaon. The tefillin we wear on our head are referred to as tefillin shel rosh, the tefillin of the head. It should be referred to as the tefillin on the head. Why is it in the of the head, not upon the head? So he says, if whatever the tefillin represent, that's fully integrated into the person, all those values, you're imbued and totally fully invested in that, then the tefillin are a representation of who you are. But if we wear tefillin, but we put it on, we take it off, and during the day, we live our lives as we choose to live our lives. And we're not attached or connected, understanding that we are God's children in this world and we have to live according to his script and his prescription of life. It doesn't have that. There you're willing to fill it on your head. It's not integrated into you. So therefore you don't resonate or you don't radiate, I should say, with what the tefillin represent. Because there's an aura which is created, but the person himself to have that aura has to have the integration into himself to give off that aura. But if that you do have that aura is sensed by others. And as a result of that, there is a reverence and there's a fear as a result of that. Mitzvah kala. Schar b'al maleko. There's no reward in this world for any mitzvah. And if you do it multiple times, so I'll give you an example. You put on tefillin, person says, I put tefillin on every day. Every moment you wear tefillin, it's a positive commandment. Every moment, every nanosecond, it's another positive commandment. So let's say a person could wear the tefillin another 5 minutes. Takes more 5 minutes early. And it's not you're rushing to go anywhere, that you're not permitted to wear the tefillin. You don't wear your tefillin in the office. You don't wear the tefillin going to work. You wear them as long as you could wear them in shul. But the person always takes off the tefillin 15 minutes before the service is over. He could wear them till the end. He's already wrapping it before it's over because he wants to get to the breakfast table or he wants to get on the cell phone to whatever it is. But what are you giving up? Well, I already did the mitzvah of tefillin today. But every moment you wear tefillin, it's a positive commandment, even two positive commands for this. The one you wear on your hand and when it, what is the value of that? Infinite value. And I'll tell you, they're manzchor shel mitzvahs. But we could go multiple situations. You have a mezuzah on your doorpost and you have a valid mezuzah. It's a positive commandment. Every second that mezuzah is on your doorpost, you're fulfilling a positive commandment where the Torah says you should put a mezuzah on the entrance to your home or every room which qualifies for that. It's a positive every second. Torah says if you have four-cornered garment and you put fringes on them, what we call tzitzis, and then the strings are made with proper, meet the criteria of what's considered tzitzis, and they're inserted in the corners and they're tied properly. You wear that four-cornered garment every moment, every nanosecond you wear that garment is a positive commandment. You know, you see the dead on Times Square, that way that thing turns, that it turns so quickly, you can't even read the numbers. The mitzvahs we do, if you do them almost without being almost aware of them, it's accumulating. You can't imagine the level of accumulation what we could accumulate in a life. It doesn't even deter us, distract us from what we're doing. Persons at the office involved in that business deal, the mezuzah's on the doorpost, he's wearing the tzitzis, he wore the tefillin in the morning, and whatever it is, or let's say he has a charity fund and he has somebody giving the charity to more people while he's in the office. All the charity that's being given is accruing to him. He has mega deals going on where he's not even actually at that moment involved in the deal. It doesn't make a difference. Could you imagine what this is? Well, you know, I only wear the tallis when I'm in shul. I don't wear the tzitzis under my shirt. Why not? Because the mitzvah is where tzitzis, but you don't understand. Are you going to pass up a deal because you're involved in something which is a fraction or infinitesimal compared to what this is? In reality wise, this is infinitesimal. Whatever you do compared to this. We have no understanding, but factually, as a believing Jew, as a Jew who studied even slightly, even if you study only Pirkei Avos, Schar Bayal Malekot, there's no reward in this world. The world is not long enough, deep enough, rich enough to compensate you for that. You know, a person has a piece of real estate, $1 billion of real estate. Person says, you know something, do you know how hard I worked for this $5? My whole life I've been saving pennies. I think you should sell me that $1 billion piece of real estate for $5. They say, are you out of your mind? No way. You have to pay value. God says, you put that penny in the charity box. As long as it supports a proper cause, the value of that, infinite value, eternity. You answer amen, one amen. You're sure people speak when they shouldn't speak. Somebody's saying Kaddish. The Shlich Tziba, the one who's leading the service, ends a blessing. And you should say amen. And you're distracted because you're talking. Or your head's elsewhere. One amen merits you a share in the world to come multiple times. And what about if you focus and you do things right? We're talking about God every day brings us mega deals. When I say mega, it's an understatement of reality of a Jew's life. Understatement. So the question is, if the way I'm saying it, even myself, if a person will come with me and say, you know, you're able to make this kind of return on your money, and it's guaranteed, I definitely wouldn't be distracted. But yet, as much as I'm talking the way I'm talking, I don't do it sufficiently. I can do it still a lot better. But knowing that fact, why don't I? The answer is, that is the challenge of life. Anything which is within the physical realm, we're naturally physical beings. When naturally you smell something which is fragrant, you naturally smell it. You don't have to pay attention. It naturally enters your nostrils. If you're awake, you're going to be touched by that fragrance. or by something else. Because we have, but our senses are physical senses. When we speak about spiritual senses, then it's not so simple because they're totally entombed in our physicality. You have to activate them. You need tremendous focus. And even when we think about them, unless you reflect, you know, we speak about people who are into meditation today. What is meditation? Think about it for a moment. Meditate, because we don't even realize, and I once said something interesting. It says in Pirkei Avos, that teaching Torah to a young person, to a young child, it's like writing something on an unblotted piece of parchment or paper. An older person, it's not the same. It's a blotted piece of paper. So I always say, meaning it doesn't stick as well. You don't retain it as well. Young person retains something very well. Now, what's the difference between an unblotted piece of paper or parchment and blotted? Now, when you write on a piece of parchment that was never written on, and you write whatever you inscribe, that ink absorbs into the parchment. So you have it's on the surface, and it becomes absorbed into the parchment to whatever degree it is. Let's say now I want to erase it. When you erase something, or on a parchment, you take a blade, and you scratch off the ink, and you write another letter on the same spot. When you write that second letter, it doesn't become as deeply embedded because under the surface, you have ink that already has been absorbed. And throughout life, if you put multiple letters and you keep scratching off the surface, it absorbs less and less continuously. And eventually, it barely attaches itself to the surface because it's so overly saturated with the previous ink that it was absorbed, the letter almost like just slips off the parchment because it doesn't have, there's no absorption whatsoever. We don't even realize. I'll give you an example. You travel with a child in a car. You better have a lot of distraction to that child. Otherwise, he's climbing the windows and he wants to get out of that car. He's totally restless. You have to keep him busy continuously. An older person, old, I don't mean older, persons, 30s, 40s, 50s. You sit there, you say, you're at peace. You're not agitated. You're not nervous. And but you're sitting doing nothing. You're sitting idly. You don't stand. As a human being, we have a conscience and we have subconscious. On the subconscious, our whole life is under there, this turmoil, this activity. We're not even aware what's going on in the subconscious. Therefore, a person could sit and he's calm or not calm because of what's already embedded in his system. When you teach a young child, that subconscious is wide open. It's an open vessel. Whatever you put in there, it fully goes in there. It's absorbed. And it's a phenomenal faculty that has the ability to contain and retain. And you could build on that. But you have all kinds of, you know, today they have, you know, you clean out the junk from your computer. The computer's full, you can't put more information in there. And they call it junk, or whatever they call it, spam, whatever they call it in there. That's the brain. That's our emotion. But we're not even aware what's in there. It's teaching a young child, it's like an unblotted piece of paper. Parchment just keeps absorbing. A person, an older person you teach, he has so much embedded under there, it barely absorbs beyond the surface. Therefore, you know, he says, I went to a lecture this morning. They said, but what did the rabbi say? He said, you know, the truth, I don't even recall. You just heard it this morning. What do you mean? You didn't recall it. Unless somehow it connects, you need some kind of like mnemonic to remember what it is. Somebody wants to know where his keys are. He has something else. He thinks about his hat, then he understands where his keys are. Because the hat is on the hat rack, and the hat rack corresponds to the drawer. And now he knows exactly where his keys are. You know, you have to come onto all these mind games to be able to know exactly where you are. That's what it is. But you realize, what about you study from the time you're young and you're older, you're going to retain even the new information. Why? Because that's a continuum of what's absorbed. You just keep building. It's an extension of what the foundation is. All your life, all you've been doing is just building a foundation. And now the structure is something which is not to be believed. It's a spiritual structure. and everything attaches and connects to the next. Once mentioned, told over a story, Ramosha Feinstein, who I mentioned him many times, he was a very holy man. He was the leading decisor in the world. And he had once given a halachic ruling, which literally he shook the world based on this, that in terms of the leniency of this ruling. He had ruled that regarding the laws of adultery, adultery is determined by the sexual act itself. But if a married woman is inseminated with another man's sperm, that's not adultery, and the child is not considered illegitimate. Not illegitimate. The legitimacy comes from the act of cohabiting with another man who's not your husband. But being inseminated with someone else's sperm, although the child is not going to be the husband's child, but that child is a kosher child, is not considered illegitimate. That was his ruling. Other people disagreed with him. Ramosha, Feinstein, being the giant, the Torah giant that he was, did not back down, okay? So there was a certain person in Israel who thought he was worth his weight in salt, and he wasn't, not even in salt. And he writes him a scathing letter, which is totally disrespectful. And even Rav Avadya Yosef, Zecharei Livracha, who's the Sephardic chief rabbi, who had encyclopedic knowledge, says, you want to disagree is one thing, but to write a letter like that to a man who's a holy, he's a pillar of Torah, unacceptable, unacceptable. And he writes him, he says, do you think you're a Torah mind, what we call Das Torah, do you think you have a right to offer such rulings? Who do you think you are? You're a nothing, this and that. And Moshe was a very humble man, very humble. Humble, you can't imagine. And he took everybody into consideration, his level of sensitivity between man and fellow, you can't imagine. It's not to be believed how special he was. And he says to him, and he never told anybody who he was, what he was. He did what he was supposed to do. Since first of all, you think you're a Torah mind, who do you think you are? You're an expert in this field. So he writes him back. He says, I want to explain to you what a Das Torah is. He says, in my life, there was never a secular thought that ever passed through my mind. Since I'm a child, my mind has only been occupied with Torah, nothing but that. So you don't tell me what a Torah mind is and what a Torah mind is not. You understand? He's that child, the unblotted piece of parchment, which continuously is being infused and embedded with only that holiness. And now he's a man in his early 80s. And when he gives that ruling, it's all based upon everything he's built throughout his life. So don't tell me what a Torah mind is and what a Torah mind is not. But if you have all that other stuff in there, and when you believe you understand what you're saying, or it's valid and there's no fallacy, that's a whole different story. And if I study Torah for one moment less, we say Talmud Torah keneged kulam. Does it really make a difference? Zor b'mitzvah kala b'chamura. Be as careful with a mitzvah kala, with a seemingly ordinary mitzvah, as a more severe mitzvah. You don't know the innate value, the payback on the mitzvah. You don't know what it is. I'll give you an example. Chofetz Chaim cites a Zohar, which was authored by Rav Shimon Yochai. That's the foundation for all Kabbalah, for the hidden understanding of the Torah. He writes, now, a person does an act of chesed. Now, you help a number of people in a very special way. So you'd say, whatever the innate value of that is, that's its value. You don't know the extent of the value of that. So you'd say, why? Because since a mitzvah is something, its value is spiritual, and we have no ability to evaluate what spiritual value is, therefore, don't, based on your perception, don't think you know what it is. It's much more than that. Therefore, don't undervalue it, and don't pass on it. But it's much more than that. Zohar says that a person does an act of chesed, loving kindness in a special way. God himself says like this, my children are the ones who need chesed. They need chesed. And look at the chesed they're doing. So I am the master of everything. I shouldn't do chesed. That's what God says. If somebody does something unusual, exceptional, in this area of chesed. My children are needy of, who are in need of chesed, do chesed. I am the master of chesed. I'm the master of everything. I shouldn't do chesed. So what happens? God will do chesed with the whole world in the merit of that one person who did that exceptional chesed. Therefore, all the chesed of that day that God does to all humanity accrues to that one person. Could you imagine? So that exceptional, whatever you did, it cost you $25,000. But what you did there was so exceptional where it really, it rattled the windows. That's how exceptional it was. But it's limited to this one location. No. What you did, you activated something that God says now, in this man's merit, the whole world is supported. I will do chesed with the whole world. Everything accrues to this one person. Could you imagine what that is? So do we have an understanding when we do anything, how you do it, when you do it, what you do, who knows what? Do you know the innate value of a mitzvah? Let's talk even more than that. I always say, anybody who's observant today, if he says the reason why he's observant is because of who he is, because the way he understands. It's arrogance. Why? Could you imagine a person has tremendous healthy constitution and he's an Olympic swimmer. He won 6 gold medals with Mark Spitz. He outswam Spitz in the Olympics. And this man says, you know something? There's a tsunami and there's a typhoon and there's a tidal wave. He's going to swim right through it. Yeah, you tell me, are you out of your mind? I'll drop you in the middle of the ocean. Let's see you swim to the other end. It's beyond human capacity. Impossible. The influences of society that seep in, that literally inundate our emotions and activate our desires, they're so overwhelming. Humanly, it's impossible. It's like a person is injected with a drug, which is addictive type drug. Once that goes in your system, you have no control of your life any longer. What we're exposed to is an opium den, inhaling it 24 hours a day, visually, what we hear, what we breathe, what we eat, everything. How do you survive it? How can you be an observant Jew? How? The answer is, it's called Zchus Avos. It's the merit of somebody who lived generations earlier, whether it was a grandfather, a grandmother, or someone, or you did something special once, and the merit of that, God says, I will protect him. Despite all this inundation, you can have a sense, and I will allow you to see truth. That's what it's about. It's not us. Humanly, it's impossible. No way. You can't survive it. You can't swim the ocean. You can't stand in front of a tsunami that's not to be swept away. The desires and the influences of this society are so overwhelming, it's impossible. Humanly, it's impossible. And now you have an ability to do a mitzvah. Not a big deal. Do the mitzvah. Mitzvah goreis mitzvah, as we said. When you do one mitzvah, it creates an energy that engulfs you and creates like a cocoon that nothing can penetrate into your encapsulation. And you're able to do even more. And the more you do, it plays on itself. It becomes literally, you could be shot out of the atmosphere with that energy. That energy doesn't exist within this world. This is something you created. So you could talk about, you should be Zor Mitzvah Kala, but you have to have an appreciation, an understanding, what is the world to come? And even if there is, I believe, but therefore what? You know, people always say, in God we trust. But who's God? Well, God is the creator. And what relevance does God have with your life? Well, God wants me to be an ethical, moral human being. And what does that mean? Well, it means whatever society says is ethical and moral, that's what it means. And what about if society is not so ethical and so moral, and they're immoral, or whatever they are? Well, God wants me to do what's right. And what's right? What I think is right. So you mean God is a figment of your own creation. You created your own image of what God is. That's what God is. God is, you do what God wants. What does God want? Well, you have to hear what he wants. After you know what he wants, now you do what he wants, not what you want, what you believe what he wants. He says, God says, a mitzvah kala. You put on that four-cornered garment with tzitzis. Every moment you wear that four-cornered garment with the tzitzis, a positive commandment, every nanosecond, the value of that has infinite worth. You're part of eternity. But who has an appreciation? You know, I have some kind of, I'm allergic to wool. Yeah, but when you put on that $3,000 suit that's wool, that was this and that, and, you go there and you look like $1 million or $1 million, all of a sudden you're not allergic to wool. Or you get it lined, and you get it lined so it shouldn't in any way irritate your skin. Somehow everything else we work out. But when it comes to the mitzvah, we don't try to work it out. We don't value it enough. But if you understood its value, what would a person do to do a deal? He won't sleep for 3 months. He won't eat for 3 months. And everything itself is third rate. Comes to a mitzvah, it has to be available in the most attractive state. Otherwise, it doesn't do it. He passes on it. And even the deal that you're supposed to do, you're not guaranteed you're going to do the deal. When you do the mitzvah, guaranteed return. Guaranteed return on your investment. So Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi, Judah the Prince, is pleading with us. This was given at Sinai. This is part of our tradition. A mitzvah kala. Don't pass on it. Don't underestimate it. That your perception, even if it's right, which probably it's not something which is less important. But even if it is, do you know the innate worth of what's less important? If an omen allows you to have a share in the world to come, so something that's more than an omen, what's its value? And repeatedly, what's the level of accumulation? You can't find a bank that can even hold it all. Where do you store all this reward? Infinite is not limited to time or space. So the location, the storage location that's waiting for us after 120 years, if you do live your life, even semi-right, you're in a very good position. Even slightly right, you're worth a fortune, as they say. You really rate. You may not rate among the greatest, but you rate. And that's exactly what Yehuda HaNasi is saying. Havi Zoyer, some say the word in Hebrew, Zahirus means radiate. You even radiate from a mitzvah kala. Even the mitzvah kala allows you to radiate. If you're careful and you value it, you're going to radiate from that. No, the Chofetz Chaim writes, it's really based on a medrash. The medrash says that a person says, I have a child, male child, and there's a mitzvah to circumcise your child. The father has this mitzvah to circumcise your child. So God says, who do you think gave him his child? If God didn't want that his wife should conceive from him, he wouldn't have a child. See, only has a child, God says, because every part of that process to have the child with the gestation in the womb and everything else, the child finally is born, and you're able to sacrifice him. How do you have the child? God gave you the child. And God gave you the ability to father that child. Now, finally, you're doing the mitzvah circumcision, which is a great mitzvah. God says, and who gives you the ability even to circumcise your child? God gives you. But if you make the decision you're going to circumcise your child, you get full credit for everything. You understand? God underwrites the whole enterprise. All you do is you just flick the switch. And who gives you the power to flick the switch? God lifts your hand to allow the switch to be lifted. And God says, you know something? You illuminated the world. You understand what this is? What's our input? Our input is only choice. That's it. Everything up to the choice, we have no relevance to that. God presents everything before you. All God says, now make the choice. And I would prefer you make the right choice. And that's what life's all about. The challenge and the ability to meet the challenge. God creates that scenario. And God gives you the ability to have the ability to meet the challenge. You may choose to go south, not north, but that's your choice. So what's a person's input in that particular moment? I always say, person's going down a river and there's a current. And how do you direct the boat? You have a rudder in the back of the boat and you just have to turn that rudder. When you turn that rudder, why does the boat go in that direction? Because you're causing it to go. It's because there's a current, and by turning that rudder, that will direct the boat. But the speed of the boat and the direction of the boat is only because you just turned that rudder. You have no control. Otherwise, you have no control over this. So all the givens that allow it to exist as it does, it's the reality of that existence. And that's exactly what life's all about. So you're in the position, say, Mitzakala, Mitzakamura. This is less important. This is not as important. That's what. And first of all, what's the alternative? If it's a question you're choosing doing more, something more important, less important, maybe we'll talk about it. But you know what you can do? You're going to go sit there and you're going to smoke your pipe with that aromatic type of tobacco. And you're going to blow smoke rings. Like they had, used to have these cigar clubs. They sat there all day smoking cigars, talking nonsense, and blowing rings. And what happens after the ring dissipates? It's like you never, and whatever, when you walk down the street, you know better than the police, the horse, the policeman's riding down the street. You know, you have no greater value than that. So what is it all about? The Chofetz Chaim writes, you know, a person's young, even though life is short. As you get older, you realize how quickly your life passed before you. But a young person believes, I'm 20 now, I have another minimally 50 years to live, 60 years to live. And with life expectancy continuously being extended, first look, you may live another 60 years, you may not live. We know many people, due to illness, due to accident, they didn't live that long. Don't say, you know, when I have time, I'll do it. You know, I first want to live life before I do that. That's people speak. You know, some, how do you know? And do you know how quickly life goes? So the Chofetz Chaim says, person already 60 years old. So let's say you have another 20 years in good health. Maybe. He asks, how do you not wake up now? Whatever happened up to this point, as they say, you can't cry over spilled milk. Well, the past is the past. But if you have 20 years left, and that's reality, you know, they used to say a joke, you know, why does a cemetery have a fence around it? Because people are dying to get in. You know, that's the reason why you have a fence. That's why a cemetery has a fence, because people are dying to get in. You know, God forbid, when it comes to die, you have no choice. They're taking you. That's where the person's going. So I'm saying, if you have that amount of time and you're a believing Jew and you understand you haven't done what you're supposed to do until now, how do you not take out time and make the corrections and make the difference, understanding how quickly life passed before your eyes? No, you remember when your father was your age now. You remember. So if you're ready there and you remember your father at that age, so now, as they say, wake up and die right. Take advantage of the years that are left in good health when you have your mind and you have your faculties and you have your function. Does it really make a difference? Of course it makes a difference. If what you're able to accumulate in a day, just wearing tzitzis, having a mezuzah on your doorpost, being circumcised, this is nanomoments accumulation, which is not even computable. And if you live your life right across the board and you study a little bit, Talmud Torah Keneged Kulam, as the Chofetz Chaim cites in the name of the Vilna Gaon, every word of Torah is a positive commandment. Every word is the equivalent of all 613 mitzvahs combined. So you study for an hour, you say 1,000 words. That's 1,000 times 613. And if you study more than an hour and in a lifetime, what have you accumulated? We're talking about numbers. There's no number which can even compute that volume of what you can. And what about if it's infused with its qualitative numbers? You did it with a reverence. You did it for the sake of the mitzvah. You didn't do it with an ulterior motive. What's its value? It's not to be imagined or understood. You know, a father speaks to a 17-year-old son, wants to give him good advice. The son, it's like water off a duck's back. Only when the son gets older, you know, as you know, they used to say, I think it's the name of Mark Twain, as I got older, my father became wiser. You know, as a child, as an immature teenager, young person, you think you know it all. And the advice your father gave you or people gave you was sage advice, sage wisdom. But you have to have a capacity to listen and pay attention and to absorb it and to implement it. Unfortunately, that's part of immaturity. It's the ego. I know better. I can do it myself. Let me first figure it out. But look at all the time you're wasting. Infinite, valuable time. But now that the time has passed and now you've matured, you want to still be that old fool. There are many old fools out there. Age has nothing to do. The Talmud says, "Ein zikna el mishakonav chokhma." Sage is the person who acquired wisdom. A young person can be a sage. He has sage wisdom, although he's a young person. Yeah, people, they're older, it means nothing. What have you learned from life? What, you haven't yet woken up. You're still the same old fool. You're in, you know, the golden age club. You play whatever you play there. Rummy and who knows whatever the card games you play over there, or shuffleboard. You know, when you go on your cruise, whatever you do there, you're wasting your time. But you know, he bought a special wardrobe to go on that cruise. Because when they drop off in the island and he wears those colored shirts, shorts with the shirt and the sandals, he thinks he's 14 years old. But the man is 76. You know, he hasn't woken up yet. But again, that you people are listening to this now, that's chus. That you're taking off time, that's mitzvah goreis mitzvah. The merit of taking and listening to this gives us, all of us, the opportunity to have a divine assistance to be touched by other things, opportunities to present themselves. And that's megalus chus al yedei zakai. You have to have merit to have merit. And that you people came to this class on a Sunday, that means you have merit. That's a good sign. You know, we always look for good signs. This is a good sign. And Be'ezrat Hashem, with Hashem's help, as this is, there'll be other good signs. And what's the proof that you're walking on the right road? When you walk down a road, every step you take, you find a treasure, you know you're on the right road. If you go down a road and every time you blow another tire with a pothole or with something else and you have your window smashed, God forbid, you know, you're in the wrong neighborhood. You don't belong on this road. But why did the other person go down the other road? He has merit. You don't have merit. You're not as meritorious. Now, this is the punchline. Person still doesn't wake up. Let's say a person's really in need of, he wants to live up to the Joneses. And he can't buy the house that the Joneses have. Can't furnish his house as the Joneses. Can't drive the car that the Joneses have. He says, you know something? I think I'm going to hold up a bank. You understand? And somebody hears this consideration. The mitzvah says, are you out of your mind? Don't you realize the liability and the consequence of even attempting to do that? Even if you succeed to take the money out of the bank, but you probably won't. And you know the price you're going to pay for that. You regret it for the rest of your life. So why consider it? So whatever decision we make, we have to understand what's going to be the consequence of that action. Is it a positive result or is it a negative result? Havim chashid hefsid mitzvah keneged tzcharo. A person, you should make an evaluation when you do a mitzvah. What am I giving up and what's its value? A mitzvah has a cost. You know, it's a cost factor. No, you send your children to yeshiva, you can send them to public school. Free education. You know, I have a son, one of my sons, people know my son, and he says to me, he works in a certain company, and the one who oversees him, he's an Italian person, man probably in his upper 60s, drives a Rolls Royce, he lives down in Palm Beach, his wife is this, wears this gold Rolex, the most expensive, this and that, and they have no children. No children. So my son says, the amount of tuition, thank God he has a large family, he pays a very large amount of his income goes to tuition. He says, don't you think if I wouldn't send my kids to to yeshiva education, I could afford the Rolex. I could afford maybe not the Rolls Royce, but I could afford a whole different kind of lifestyle. But I've chosen to pass on that and put it where I want to put it. Invest it in my children. They should have a Torah education and live a certain way of life. So I don't have the Rolls Royce and I don't have the Rolex. And I don't have that wardrobe. Therefore what? That's what it's about. So whenever you do a mitzvah, there's always a cost factor. Matzah. Every year, the price per pound keeps going up. Shmuel matzah this year was $35 a pound. You understand? Loaf of bread doesn't cost that. Even if you go to some fancy type of gourmet type shop, you don't pay $35 a pound for a pound of bread. Well, but that's what the mitzvah cost. But what's the mitzvah? There's a mitzvah to eat the volume of an olive at the Seder in a reclining position. And you know what that is? That's the that is more than the value, more than the challenge it cost. Swallowing that kezias, that's the innate value of that. $35, do you know what kind of buy that is? It's only a means to an end. It's not what you're doing. It's what that accomplishes. So take a look at the cost of the mitzvah versus the reward you get for the mitzvah. You know, I prefer sit and read the Wall Street Journal or some other nonsense. Not that it's something you have to read because you have to know what kind of decision to make tomorrow. I just want to know what's going on. Therefore, are they conservative? Are they liberal? What are they? You could sit and study Torah that hour. But you realize, but when I go and I shoot the breeze with my friends, I can't quote the Wall Street Journal or the European Herald Tribune. And I can't do this. But understand, there's always a cost factor. What are you giving up for the mitzvah? When you give up for the mitzvah, what's the return on that? When you start making those calculations, is it really worth passing on the mitzvah? For the reason you're passing on it, understanding what you're giving up, because what you're giving up has infinite worth. So therefore, a person has to have that level of focus. The benefit of a sin, you know what the cost is going to be? It's the person holding up the bank because he wants to live up to the Joneses. You know something? The price you're going to pay, it's not worth it. The momentary pleasure, momentary, I mean literally momentary, but even a lifetime is momentary. Because versus eternity, 70 years is momentary. So if you take this into account, whatever you do, you use that yardstick. Cost versus profit. Gain versus cost. And you have a belief and an understanding. And you have an orientation. And you make a choice, that an environment that should be conducive, that you should have sense, you should be sensible to be able to make that evaluation. Then you maximize on every opportunity that's presented before you. We're going to stop here, talk about this for a lifetime. If we did, every one of us would be a tzaddik. So now I'm going to give the challenge should be a little bit of each of us should meet our own challenge and we should succeed. And we should understand that there's no such thing as an ordinary mitzvah, because every, even the ordinary, is something which is exceptional. Okay.
Thank good you, Rabbi.
Everybody have a good day. 11 o'clock, we have Daf Yomi today.
See you later, Rabbi.
Alan, good to see you.
Take care, Rabbi.
John, good to see you. You should come on every day. We miss you. Okay.
Bye-bye, Rabbi.
Bye. Bye.